at the screen now. And start is now view full screen mode.
Okay. And I've been trying actually to move towards some of the equations to write them directly on the board rather than using slides, because that slows me down and also, should we say, helps a little bit. The only thing I forgot to ask him, this is the first time I use this room. I'm used to using room H, blackboard and slides. If I do this, blackboard only. Oh, no. It's very poorly lit, the blackboard here, no? I was wondering if there was a way of switching on. Here we go. Maybe just I familiarise myself with the lights. No, that doesn't help. Okay, just if I need to write the blackboard. So, the course, as we see, is split between the thermodynamics at the beginning, dry, and then we add moisture. So we start to add the thermodynamics of water vapour in the atmosphere. And then we have, this year I've moved the topic forward, and we're going to discuss radiative transfer in the atmosphere. Then we move on to basically the energy budget of the Earth atmosphere system, basically the top of the atmosphere energy budget, the surface energy budget. And then we go from that talking very briefly about, should we say, energy transfers, first of all in the boundary layer near the surface, and then through the whole atmosphere, basically in the lowest layer that we're going to talk about today. Okay. And then finally we go down then, we zoom in on the physics of clouds in the last section, where we actually, as I mentioned, start to look at the processes of cloud formation, rainfall formation. And so we start to understand some of the questions why, for example, why is it that we often see clouds but they don't always produce precipitation? You know, the vast majority of clouds form and dissipate without producing any rainfall at all. And yet some clouds, as we've seen just in the last few days, can produce very, very intense precipitation. So I hope by the end of this course you'll understand some of these questions about, should we say, cloud formation, circulations in convection clouds, and how the energy budget of the Earth is actually working. Okay. So before we get on to the energy, section, the radiation section, we just start by way of kind of introduction. We say that basically objects can lose or gain energy by the emission or absorption, for example, of electromagnetic radiation. Okay. We'll see in the radiation part of the course that the mean frequencies of that radiation emitted depends on the temperature of the body in question. Okay. And we're going to see in the radiation part of the course that the Earth's surface and the gases and clouds that are present in the atmosphere can either scatter radiation into a different direction, so the photons can be scattered into a different direction, or they can absorb radiation. And we're going to see that this occurs at specific frequencies of wavelengths of radiation. Okay. So all of this will become clear when we get onto the radiation section of the course, okay? So the Earth atmosphere system basically receives radiation from the sun, and most of that energy is in this kind of wavelength of 0.2 to 4 microns, okay? Some of this radiation is absorbed by the surface, or it's reflected back to space by the atmosphere, while the rest is basically absorbed by the atmosphere. So some of that radiation is absorbed by the surface, some is reflected back to space by the clouds. Okay. So this is what we're going to be talking about when we get to the radiation part of the course. Okay. Instead, the Earth, which is at a much lower temperature, is going to be emitting radiation at a much longer wavelength. So the radiation part of the course, we're going to be looking at the water physics behind this. Radiation is not distributed equally over the globe, okay, so the tropics receive much more energy than the sun. So we're going to see a picture of this now. So just as a way of the background, so what I'm showing here is we have latitude on the x-axis here, okay, so we're going from 80 north, this is the North Pole, almost down to almost the South Pole, okay, 80 south. And then we basically have on the y-axis a measure of energy. So what we see here is essentially we've got this top line here is showing us the energy that's received from the sun. Okay. And this middle line here that starts here and is also higher near the equator, this is a zonal average around all the longitudes, is also higher near the equator. But the difference between the equator and the high latitudes is less. And this is the energy that's emitted to space by the Earth. Okay. So the integral underneath these two basically balances. Okay, the energy in equals the energy out if we average over a long period of many years. Okay. Why do we know that's the case? To a very good approximation, why do we know that the integral under these two curves, weighted by the cosine of the latitude, of course, why does the integral of the two have to basically balance? What would happen if they didn't balance? And it is actually happening. We're going to talk about this in the course as well. There is actually a small difference between the two. So what would happen if we had more energy in than energy out in the Earth atmosphere system?
That become too warm if the incoming radiation is more than the outgoing radiation.
Exactly. So if we have more energy in than energy out, what would happen is the temperature of the Earth atmosphere system would increase. It is actually happening, of course. Why is it actually happening?
Because of CO2.
Exactly. So human emissions, exactly, is increasing the CO2 in the atmosphere.
Okay.
And we're actually pushing this out of balance. Now, of course, there are also natural phenomena that also cause this balance to vary over time. Okay. And we're going to talk about those in the course as well. Things such as changes in the orbit of the Earth. Okay. And things such as volcanic eruptions and so on. All of these things on either shorter timescales, maybe decadal timescales, a few year time, so like volcanoes, for example, have perturbations to the energy balance that have an e-folding time of about a year or so. So after 2-3 years, usually most volcano, should we say, influences have pretty much disappeared. Things like Mount Pinatubo in 1991 had an influence on temperatures for 2-3 years afterwards. Okay. You know, extremely rare super volcanoes could have a much larger, longer-lasting impact, of course. Things such as orbital variations have impacts, as we'll see, on timescales of tens of thousands of years. The sunspot cycle, okay. So that's another example of something that's working basically on a shorter but multi-year timescale, where you have basically variations of about 1 watt per meter squared, in the top of the atmosphere balance, just due to fluctuations in the sun's output. Okay. Okay. So these are all things we're going to talk about in when we get to the radiation part of the course about this energy balance. But to a good approximation, okay, these two pretty much balance. You know, if there was a big difference, you know, temperatures would be rising by tens of degrees every year, which obviously doesn't happen. Okay. But they don't balance everywhere. What's happening if we look at the equator? What do we have, more energy in or more energy out? At the equator.
We have more energy in.
Exactly, so we receive more energy from the sun at the equator than we actually, the Earth system emits to space locally. So that's why this is kind of colored red. It's kind of red for hot. And then at the high latitudes, if we look at the poles, we find the opposite is true. Okay, here we have less incoming solar radiation than energy that's emitted to space. Okay, so you might ask yourself, what's going on? Why do we not find that the tropical temperatures keep going up and up and up, and the temperatures at the poles keep going down, down, down? Why is that? What causes this? We still have locally more or less an equilibrium. We have a seasonal cycle of temperatures, of course, and we'll talk about that as well. So why do you think it is that what maintains the balance?
This is maybe it's because of the position of Earth with the solar radiation, with the heating solar radiation.
No? What did you want to say?
I wanted you to repeat the question.
So the question is, if we just look at the tropics, we have more energy in than energy out. Okay. In the high latitudes, we have more energy out than energy in. So if we looked at just the tropics, if we've got more energy in and energy out, what would we expect? We'd expect the temperature to keep going up. Okay. But that doesn't happen. We have an equilibrium, more or less. Temperatures are more or less stable. The temperature in the tropics, it changes from year to year a little bit, but it's not that we have an upward, very strong trend there and a very strong cooling trend at the poles. Forget about global warming for the moment. Okay, that's a background slow trend upwards.
The atmosphere, the like make the heat go like up from here under.
Exactly. So we have energy transport. Okay. So the excess of energy here is transported towards the poles by the atmosphere, but also by the ocean. Okay. So we have heat transport by motions in the atmosphere. Okay. So we're going to talk about different ways heat can be transported, okay, especially shorter later, and also that will be covered much more extensively in the second term's course on atmospheric dynamics. Okay, so we don't talk too much about dynamics here. So if we go, this is another, shall we say, diagram that shows this. So we have this energy surplus, energy deficit, and then we have the surplus heat from the tropics is basically transported towards the poles by, should we say, circulations in the atmosphere and the ocean. Okay. And so this is a schematic of these, should we say, cells that we have in the atmosphere, which I, again, are not covered very much in this course, but they're covered later in the dynamics course, where we have basically this overturning Hadley cell. We will be talking about this circulation when we get to the convection part of the course, where convection near the equator, it's actually mostly slightly off the equator. This is a very idealized diagram. So in the Pacific Ocean, for example, the convection band sits mostly around 10 degrees north of the equator. Okay, and then in the Western Pacific, there's another band that's less extensive that stretches to the south of the equator. So the convection is actually slightly off the equator. Okay. And the reasons for that are quite interesting, that are associated with the ocean dynamics and the fact that we have divergence and upwelling cold water actually right at the equator. So the warmest temperatures actually tend to be off the equator. Okay. But these cells, where the air goes up in these convection clouds that we're going to be talking about in basically chapter 4/5 of the course, the air that goes up in these clouds then basically descends slowly in the environment, so in this kind of descending branch of the Hadley circulation. This cell is limited due to the rotation of the Earth. Okay, into this. So we actually find that these circulations split up into these Hadley cells and then these spheral cells. So we actually have three distinct cells where we have energy transported towards the poles. Okay. So, a little bit of introduction, as I said again more, let's talk a little bit about the structure of the atmosphere. So if we now take a profile through the atmosphere, okay. Now in this case here, this is a global mean, so we're no longer showing a diagram with latitude, okay. So here on the x-axis, I'm now showing temperature in kelvins, okay. And on the y-axis, I'm showing height, okay. And so we see here a mean structure of the temperature in the atmosphere. And again, there'll be local variations. We'll see that in the next couple of slides. Okay. So this is in kilometers here. So we have 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 kilometers. So what we see about the structure of the temperature is it's actually quite interesting. If we look in the lowest slab of the atmosphere, which goes up to around 10 kilometers, and this really depends where you are on the globe. So in the tropics, this, should we say, border between these bottom two layers is actually deeper, around 15 kilometers. Whereas in mid-latitudes here, it's probably around 10 or 11. As you go towards higher latitudes, it can become even lower. Okay. So this is a mean picture. So in this lowest slab, the temperature is cooling with height. Okay. We're going to see why this is. We see, and we're going to work out from theory roughly what we expect that drop in temperature to be. Okay, approximately. And where this actually comes from. Okay. Then we reach this boundary, which is actually defined by the point where temperature ceases to decrease with height, and the sign of the tendency changes. So you see that the temperature then becomes stable and starts to increase with height. Okay. So we call this lowest layer, where the temperature is decreasing, the troposphere. Okay. The layer above this, where temperature increases, is the stratosphere, and it starts to drop again in the mesosphere, and then it starts to increase again in the thermosphere. But we'll see actually here the whole definition of temperature starts to get a little bit hazy because there are so few molecules, the pressure is so low here, that the whole definition of temperature starts to get a little bit shaky, and we'll talk about that in the dry thermodynamics. Okay. So we're going to talk about the reasons why temperature drops off here, and why it starts to increase here, which we'll see is due to absorptions of gases that are found in this specific layer in the atmosphere. Okay. Now, most of the course, in terms of the convection dynamics and under clouds and so on, really focus on what's going on in this layer, or even the very lowest layer in just the first few hundred meters. Okay. Why do you think that is? Well, we concentrate on this layer because this is really where all the weather is going on. What we're going to find out, in fact, that this temperature structure is always at a very interesting point of being quite close to being unstable. Okay, and when it gets too unstable, then you get vertical motions kicking off, okay, which in the tropics are in the form of, should we say, thunderstorms and convection clouds, so the kind of things that we've been having rolling through here. In mid-latitudes, that instability is more in the form of, should we say, barotropic, systems of weather and weather fronts. Okay. So most of the convection part, I'll be talking more about the kind of weather that we see in the tropics. Okay. So this is where a lot of interesting dynamics is going on. And it's also, of course, where we live, right down here on the bottom of this diagram. Okay. So most of the course is going to be focusing on what's going on in that layer there at the bottom. Okay. Now, as I mentioned, that was a kind of global averaged view. Okay. If we actually look at different locations, so this diagram here splits the globe up into, different regions. Okay. So we still have temperature on the x-axis, which is now actually in degrees C. Okay. And on the y-axis here, we have altitude still. But notice now the diagram stops at 20 kilometers. So it's really zooming in already on that lowest layer of the troposphere. Okay. And what we see here is, this is from reanalysis data. This is actually quite an old plot I made, so it's an old reanalysis. But the picture wouldn't change very much with the latest data. And we see that we split it up into, again, bands. So here, this solid line is averaging right around the globe in the tropics, from 10 south to 10 north. Okay, so we have a tropical band here. Then we have a dotted line here, which is basically 40 north to 50 north. Okay, and then I've plotted here 70 to 84 north with the long dashed lines. Okay, so what do we see in the tropics? If we look close to the surface, on the mean, it's warmer than it is at very high latitudes. That's no big surprise, no? And when we're planning our holidays, we normally prefer to go to the tropics than 70 or 80 north if you like sun and hot weather. Okay, if you like snow, of course, this is where we head for cross-country skiing. But anyway, but what we notice about the gradients is fairly similar, no? So when we come to the actual physics, the physics that sets these gradients in some way is quite similar if we look at these, different latitudes. But what we see is that the point of the tropopause actually, as I was mentioning earlier, decreases as we go to higher and higher latitudes. So the tropopause height in the tropics is occurring around 15 to 16 kilometers, okay? Whereas when we get to high latitudes, then at 10 kilometers is already, in the stratosphere. So if you take a long distance flight, as most of you did to come here, often the trajectories, if you're flying from Asia to Europe, then your trajectory can often, the great arc, go quite close to the pole. And so a large part of your journey, the aeroplane is actually flying in the stratosphere, not in the troposphere. Okay, you're flying above the tropopause. So when we come to supersaturation aircraft contrails, we'll see that why clouds can often be created by, should we say, aeroplanes when they're in the upper troposphere, just before they cross over into the stratosphere, which is then extremely dry in terms of relative humidity. Whereas we'll find that this layer just below the tropopause can actually be very, very moist and therefore lead to, should we say, cloud formation. Okay. So in the dry thermodynamics course, I'll be coming back to this table. I just wanted to introduce it here in the kind of introduction section when we talk about the atmosphere. So the atmosphere, as you all know, is made up of major and minor constituents. Okay. So the vast majority, if we look at the concentration by volume, is basically it's made up of these first two entries in the table. So it's almost 78, so it's just over 78% by volume of nitrogen, okay, and then 21% by volume of oxygen, okay. And then we have some of these more minor constituents, okay. So you can see again, this table I put into the course a couple of years ago. How can you tell that this table is a better update, that I haven't updated it for a couple of years? The oxygen? It hasn't changed that much, the oxygen. What do you think has changed since I...
CO2.
What's the value these days? Does anybody know? So here we have 380 parts per million volume, this stands for. Does anybody know what the value is now in 2020? Okay, Google it after the class, okay, and then tomorrow when we come to the class, you'll be able to tell me what it is. I know roughly what it is within one or two, but, okay, so you will have to know tomorrow what the current, should we say, value of CO2 concentration is by tomorrow's lesson, okay, and it's more, I'll give you a clue, it's more than 380, okay. So, it's actually, when you look back, it's quite shocking. I mean, the increase, while I've been alive, is, I think, as a percentage, is about 30%. I mean, just in my lifetime, in terms of the gas. Now, of course, global warming skeptics always say, parts per million? Say 380 per million, that seems really, really small. It's just a minor constituent, no, compared to the others. But of course, that says nothing about its radiative signature. Okay, so we're going to be looking in the radiation part of the course at the whole spectrum of the, should we say, the radiation at the important wavelengths I mentioned right at the beginning of today. And we're going to see how important CO2 is actually blocking, should we say, the radiation from the Earth from being emitted to space by absorbing it and then re-emitting it both in the upwards but also in the downwards direction, okay, and leading to warming. Another important greenhouse gas that we're having an impact on in this table, of course, is methane. So again, methane, this entry here is out of date. Okay, it's actually quite a bit higher now. So a number of these gases, we'll see, some of these you'll see popping up in the news all the time. So things like ozone. Why is ozone traditionally been in the news and also today is in the news? There are two reasons why you sometimes see ozone mentioned in terms of
ozone.
The ozone holes. That was one where chemicals that we used in refrigerators, okay, basically once refrigerators were scrapped and those chemicals escaped, it turned out we found in the 1980s were acting as a catalyst for a naturally occurring reaction with sunlight that destroyed ozone and so led to an ozone hole over the poles, particularly over the southern pole where the circulation is much, much more zonal. So these, a little bit like the gyres in the ocean, people talk about the gyres for the plastic and the plastic gets caught in the middle of these circulations. It's the same in the south pole, The ozone is not mixed out very effectively because the flow is very zonal around the South Pole, whereas around the North Pole there's much more undulations, so the mixing in and out of the polar area is much stronger because there's more land in the Northern Hemisphere. So the land and the flow around it disturbs the motions much more. And so the ozone hole in the Northern Hemisphere has always been much weaker as a result of the fact that there's more land masses here. It's also a chemical where it's very nice or good for us if it's in the stratosphere, because it protects us from very short-wave radiation from the sun, okay, which if it's allowed through can cause cancers, cause mutations of plants and animals. Okay. But at ground level it's not very good. Okay. So I'm not going to be talking about that, of course. You might be covering that, I hope, in the chemistry course with Andrea, which I'm not that familiar with the syllabus because he's teaching it for the first time this year, so he's probably changed the syllabus quite a lot. I haven't had a chance to keep up with the changes, but it's one of the, should we say, it can be produced at low level by reactions as a result from our emissions in town centres and so on. Okay. Same with nitrous oxide. Okay. Before I forget, if we look at the table on the right-hand side, we can see that most of these have a value that's given. Okay. So what does that tell us? It means that mostly, probably with the exception here, because here we have a range as well, so ignore that, but most of the others means that the reaction timescales usually are fairly slow. So if we take carbon dioxide, there will be local variations, because obviously if you have a factory or a power station that's emitting CO2, you have a local source. Okay, but that CO2 very quickly gets mixed and it's not very reactive as a gas. So what does that mean? It means the residence times in the atmosphere are very long. The processes that by which CO2 is removed, such as absorption by the oceans or uptake by plants, are quite slow processes. You'll see that there is, I'll show you a diagram in a moment, there are oscillations on a seasonal timescale due to the growing seasons. Okay. But those oscillations are quite small compared to the concentration of the gas. Okay, it's not going from 0 to 380, back down to 0 and so on. And if you measure it in this room, or you measure it on the top of the mountains in the Alps, or if you measure it down in Ghana, in Accra, or in the US, the percentage variation is very small. Okay, because those reaction times are slow. Okay. Should we say, compared to the processes that add or, remove CO2. So we can say that it's well mixed in the atmosphere. Okay, it doesn't vary that much. It's the same with oxygen. Okay, the actual oxygen content by, volume is pretty much well mixed. Okay, if we go up the mountain and we have breathing difficulty, it's not because the oxygen by volume percentage is changing, it's just simply that the pressure is lower, so there's simply less of it per se. You know, there's less atmosphere up there, so by extension there's less oxygen for us to breathe, the pressure is lower. But the actual concentration by volume doesn't change. Okay. But there's one entry in that table which it does change, which is pretty clear to see straight away. Which one is it?
Water
vapor. Water vapor, exactly. So water vapor is highly variable. Okay. Because in that case, it's the processes by which it's removed are fast, rainfall generation we'll see, and also its concentration varies tremendously because we'll see it actually depends on temperature. So we're going to derive how it changes as a function of temperature. Okay. So we're going to see that water vapor can be highly variable in the atmosphere.
So this is what I was saying already.
So this is a diagram of how water vapor changes. So we can see, again, we have, this is a measure of water vapor, okay, which is called the specific humidity. So in section two, probably next week when we start to do moisture thermodynamics, I'll be introducing this term specific humidity, along with several other ways where we measure water vapor content in the atmosphere, things such as mixing ratio, absolute humidity, and one that you've probably all heard of because it's one that's used much more frequently, relative humidity. Okay. So I'll be introducing all of these basically in the next lecture, but you can basically see that the units are grams per kilogram, so without saying the exact definition, it's a measure of the mass of water vapor per mass of the atmosphere, kind of a ratio of the humidity to the mass, okay? So there are actually two very close definitions I'll be introducing to you. One is the mass per dry mass and one is the mass per moist mass. They're almost the same, okay? But for the moment, you can just think of it as a kind of a ratio of the water vapor to the atmosphere. Now, basically what we see on the x-axis then is this measure of water vapor, and again on the y-axis we see altitude. Okay, so we're going up in the atmosphere, and again I've cut it off near the troposphere, okay. So what do we see is, again, the humidity value is much higher in the tropics, 10 south to 10 north, than it is at high latitudes, okay. So the further north or south we go away from the equator, okay, the less water there is in the atmosphere. Okay. So that reminds us of something. That was actually also the truth of temperature, because at high latitudes it's colder. So we can see colder, also less water vapor. So we're going to see why this is, but essentially the amount of water vapor we can see in the atmosphere is kind of limited by the saturation value. And if we go beyond that, we actually start to condense excess water into droplets, okay? And we're going to see why that happens later in the course, okay? And we also see if we go up in the atmosphere, we also get a decrease, a strong decrease in the water vapor. And this happens very quickly, so the E-folding distance is roughly 2 kilometers in the vertical, okay? So if you kind of fit in an exponential function to this, the E-folding distance is around, the tau is around 2 kilometers, okay? So do you understand what I mean if I say that?
Where are the children?
Oh, there we are, yes. So if we just try and a function of height, so we say we just fit a function, so we just say q naught is some kind of fitting parameter, and then we have x of basically z over tau, okay. So we fit q zero, which is essentially this value here on this graph, because when z is zero, then we've got e to zero, which is just one, of course, okay. So that's q zero is the value at z equals zero at the surface. Okay. And this tau in this equation will be around 2 kilometers to get a rough fit. Okay. So when I talk about the E-folding distance, it's the value of this tau here. Okay. So if this is measured in meters, this would be 2,000 meters, roughly, give or take. Of course, if you look at any particular profile, we'll see if you actually launch a radio sonde, a balloon that's measuring water vapor as it goes up through the atmosphere here, on any particular day, it doesn't look like this nice and smooth. You actually get very strong oscillations in height. Okay, we'll be looking at some diagrams, basically, of that. By the way, how many of you actually have I'm trying to remember from the applications, how many of you actually have a background at all in anything like meteorology? Has any of you actually studied any meteorological classes before coming here? You, two of you, okay. So things such as tephigrams, are you familiar with? Tephigram, maybe?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So one or two.
For me, I studied geophysics during my courses.
Okay.
But when I was, my thesis was about external geophysics.
Okay.
So I studied the radiation coming from sun and its impact in ionosphere.
Okay.
So far, so I had the chance to see a little bit about atmosphere and stuff like that.
So some of you will be familiar with some of the concepts, especially. So when we do the exercise classes, especially you two with the tephigrams, you'll be helping the others a lot, I think. Okay, good. So we're going to see why this this drop-off occurs as we go up in height. Okay. When it comes, because in fact, we talk about CO2 in terms of like global warming, but we're actually going to see that the most important greenhouse gas in the atmosphere is actually water vapor. Okay, it's even more powerful than CO2. Okay. And so we can see that the water vapor, we're going to see how it depends on temperature. So if temperature increases with global warming, we can expect increases in the humidity in the atmosphere as well. Okay. And we're going to see, in fact, that that can actually act to amplify the response that we expect in terms of what we call a positive feedback in terms of climate sensitivity. Okay. And it's important both in the upper troposphere as well as the lower troposphere, because the percentage change in water vapor is what's important. Okay. So as I was just mentioning, this is just saying about carbon dioxide, and the carbon dioxide amounts have increased over time. Okay. So let me just show a diagram here. I should get rid of those tech slides, actually. So what we're showing here, again, this is 10 years out of date. I'm embarrassed, actually. I should update this now. This is carbon dioxide, basically shown on the top. This is the year on the x-axis, and it's just showing the last 30 years. Okay. And so we can see how the carbon dioxide is increasing over time. This is the rate of change. What have we noticed? This is the long-term trend in the dashed line, but each year we see these oscillations. Okay. What's the main driver, do you think, of those oscillations in the carbon dioxide? So each of these bumps is 1 year. So it's an annual cycle. What do you think is causing those bumps?
Seasonal
variations. Seasonal variations? In what way? What's causing those seasonal variations?
The rotation.
Hmm?
What causes the seasonal
variations in carbon dioxide?
During the summer season, because of the sun, there are more trees, so they produce more of the...
That's right.
Take up more.
So it's associated with vegetation. But when we say during the summer season, when it's summer in the north, it's winter in the south, and vice versa. So how come we see this cycle? So which summer season sees a drop in the CO2? The summer season in the north or the summer season in the south?
Yeah.
In the north, because we have more land, don't we? Of course. So it's dominated by the northern hemisphere summer. So we're in the summer in the north, the extra increase in the vegetation, we see a net uptake of CO2 and it drops. Okay. And then we basically, as we get the die back in the winter, so the leaves are about to start dropping off the trees now, probably back in further north. I'm from England. There probably already the leaves are starting to turn. And so in those locations already, the CO2 then, as those leaves start to rot and so on, that you actually get the CO2 emitted. So we can see an increase. Okay. But the drop in the summer, the spring and the summer, is never as large as the increase in the winter, because underlying this is our consumption of fossil fuels, which leads to this long-term trend, okay? Which you can see changes its slope. There was actually, in 2007 and 2008, it got flat for a few years with the economic crisis, and then it picked up again. Also this year with the COVID lockdown, you actually see a small dent in the CO2. It's always depressing, actually, when you shut down half of the industry around the globe, and it's still, you know, CO2 still keeps increasing. It just increased more slowly, actually. Okay. And then this was just a plot showing the ozone, again, and it was showing how we have this, should we say, long-term trend of measurements in ozone, where we actually kind of reached a minimum in the early 2000s in ozone. And locally, specifically on timescales of weeks, the ozone, sometimes over the southern hemisphere, locally can actually reach zero in the column. Okay, so there are some instances where it's almost completely absent, the ozone. I should actually put in a simulation of this. Oh, maybe this, does this allow me to, does this work? Doesn't. Okay, ready. Okay. And then towards the end of the course, after covering the radiation, we're going to go on to cloud physics, okay, which is my favorite part of the course, okay, because it's where I've spent most of my research. My research here has two halves, basically. So traditionally, I've always been involved in research of how to represent clouds and convection in large-scale models, so either climate models or in forecast models, weather forecast models or seasonal forecast models, in so-called parameterization schemes. And I'll be teaching that in the second terms course, where I talk about modeling much more, so you have much more hands-on experience of working with climate data, working with model output, and understanding how models are actually simulating the atmosphere and the processes that we talk about in this course. Okay, that's kind of fun. And I also here actually, I do a little bit, it's a little bit strange, I don't lecture in this course, but I've also got a little bit into health modelling, so I do a bit of modelling in malaria and seasonal forecasting malaria, particularly in Africa, in fact. So if any of you want to know more about that, I'm happy to talk about that offline, of course, outside the classes. So this is a diagram of, shall we say, a cloud from a satellite. Okay, it's actually from infrared. Okay, so it's measuring essentially the cloud top temperature. So where you see kind of darker greys, these are where the cloud tops are low and therefore warm, because the clouds usually, to a good approximation, have the same temperature as the atmosphere at that height where they are found. Okay, so if you remember, when we looked at the temperature, we actually had temperature dropping off with height. Okay, so if this is temperature and this is height, if we have a cloud in the upper troposphere, its cloud top will have a much colder temperature than a cloud that's found in the lower atmosphere, because the difference in the temperature between clouds and the environment never normally exceeds more than 1 or 2 degrees. Okay, here, so if you remember, in the tropics, we might be looking at a tropical pulse temperature of around 195, 200 Kelvin, and down at the surface, 300 Kelvin. So this variation here is on the order of 100 Kelvin. So the perturbation between the cloud temperature and the external temperature of 1 or 2 Kelvin is just on the order of 1% compared to the variation in height across the troposphere. So to a good approximation, when we look at the cloud temperature, okay, with a satellite, it pretty much tells us the height of the cloud. Why? Because we'll see that clouds actually are extremely effective at absorbing and emitting radiation in the wavelengths, in the long wavelengths that are emitted at the temperatures of objects that of such as the surface of the Earth. Okay, we'll talk about that in irradiation. So what you really need to know now with this plot is we're just looking at cloud top temperature. Okay, these whites are bright high clouds, okay, and these greys are low warm clouds. Okay, so if we look at this here, we can see that clouds are pretty ubiquitous, actually. So clouds are pretty common. Does anybody have an idea what the average global cloud cover is, roughly, to within, say, 5-10%? You could probably hazard a guess just by looking at that snapshot there. And what would you say before you looked at this plot? Any of you? I asked this question just last week to somebody who works actually in health. So she works for the health service in I won't say which country, but as a colleague of mine, we've worked together a couple of times. And I said to her, what do you think the average cloud cover is? And she said 5%, that was her guess. So I think she must live in a very nice location, actually. Yeah. Anybody have any ideas? Go on, you can just guess, it's fun. It's the first lecture, I'm not gonna get upset.
50 to 20?
18 to 20?
50 to 20?
15 to 20? Anybody else have an idea? You can shout from Zoom as well. I keep looking at you there, I should look at you with the camera. You can shout from Zoom as well.
Mm.
20 to 30%. 20 to 30? Any other ideas? You'll be surprised, it's quite a lot higher. So it's actually on the order, and it depends how you measure it, okay? Because you have to say, well, how do you actually count a pixel as being cloudy? So it depends on the instrument that you measure it with, and so on and so forth. But it's on the order of 65%. So roughly two-thirds at any one time, okay? So locations such as the high latitudes are extremely cloudy, but it's actually quite common in the tropics with all this convection going on, okay? So, it's not always, it's really the only places that are, you know, very commonly cloud-free. If you remember the diagram we had of those circulations, so if you look at somewhere like Africa, you have the air going up in these storms that follows the migration of the sun. So you have like an African monsoon in West Africa that peaks basically in, say, August. It starts in, it's like July, August, September, okay, and then it recedes and the rains move south. Okay, but over the Sahara Desert and then over Namibia here, that's where the air is going down. And when it goes down, it tends to be much, much drier. So in these descending branches of that Hadley circulation I showed you just a few slides ago, those areas can be very much cloud-free with a very low percentage of cloud. But they only cover certain restricted zones, okay? Whereas in the mid-latitudes, and at high latitudes, or in the tropical convective areas, like over the somewhere like Indonesia, you know, you have rainy seasons where the cloud fraction is actually very high for extended periods, even though you have a diurnal cycle, so it depends on the time of day and so on. But if you integrate globally over all times, the rough approximate cloud percentage is 65. And as I said, it depends on the measure. So it's quite surprisingly high. And those clouds we're going to see are extremely important. I just mentioned one reason, for example. I said that they're very effective absorbers and emitters in the infrared. Okay. And you'll see that particularly here, okay, in the winter, because here we often get wind that comes down from the mountains. So it's descending, so it's dry. Remember that diagram with the water vapor dropping off of height. So if the air is moving down and it just carries its properties with it, it can be very dry. So here it's actually, although we're close to the sea, if the wind is from the Bora direction and it comes down from the mountains, it can actually have a very low relative humidity here. That's why I like the climate a lot here for that reason. It's only in the summer when you get very high pressure blocking the systems and you get the influence of the sea and you can get much more humid in the hot weather. In the winter, it's often very dry, surprisingly. But what you'll see here in the winter, and I'll start to point it out, Sesame Mother, is in the winter, because it's dry, the surface is very effective at losing its energy to space if it's cloud-free. So the nights can get extremely cold, not right down close to the coast, but just have to go a couple of kilometres up to Opportuno and the castle there, and it's very, very dry, and so you'll find that at night, it's a huge loss of energy to space, and the temperatures can really, really drop. But if it's cloudy, that doesn't happen, because that cloud absorbs the infrared radiation and emits it back down towards the surface. Okay, so we'll see that. I'll point it out. We'll look at some instruments during the lectures sometimes when it's extremely strong. And you'll see that cycle of temperatures is massively impacted by the presence or not of low clouds. Okay. But what else do clouds do? They don't just impact the radiation that's emitted from the surface of the Earth. We're going to see in the radiation part of the course that they're also important for another wavelength of radiation, which is from the sun. Okay? We all know, especially this time of year, where you start to notice when it gets cooler. No? At the weekend, when it was sunnier outside, you can still be in a t-shirt, but if a cloud goes in front of the sun, you immediately feel it. Why is that? It's because the cloud is also interacting strongly with the radiation at those wavelengths, okay? But it's not absorbing it.
Diffracting it.
It's basically reflecting it, that's right. It's scattering the photons, and a lot of those photons get scattered back out towards space. So the clouds, essentially, we will see when we get to the radiation part of the course, they act to make the Earth atmosphere system more shiny. Okay, so we'll see that the clouds are actually, for the radiation, the energy budget, are extremely interesting because they have two opposing effects. okay, they can stop the Earth from cooling in terms of its emission of radiation, but they can also, on the other hand, cool it by reflecting radiation back to space. And which of those two effects dominates depends on the height of the cloud. Okay. And also, to a lesser extent, but also to a certain degree, the optical thickness of the clouds. Okay. So we'll see that the signature of whether clouds warm or cool will depend if they're thin or thick, or if they're low or high. So we'll be talking about that in the radiation part of the course. Okay. So it's an extremely important component of the Earth atmosphere system and of the energy budget. Okay. And it makes them super interesting. The other thing that's really interesting about them, of course, as I already alluded to, is they sometimes rain. Okay. So the processes inside the clouds, the phase changes leads to heating, okay, that helps to basically, we'll see, drive circulations. Okay, I have to be careful how I say that because it's very easy to be misleading. But basically, they play a part of the dynamics. It's cloudy where the air is going up, and we'll see the phase change provides heat that acts to help drive those circulations. And also, they play a role in the hydrology. Okay, so we'll see, and we'll be talking about the nitty-gritty zooming down, and talking about how the cloud droplets form, how they bump into each other and form raindrops, how those droplets may freeze and actually cause ice crystals, which have different radiative properties, and we'll see some interesting behaviour. Okay, and this will link into aerosols. So we'll be talking about both their impact in terms of the hydrology in this course, but also in terms of the radiation and the energy balance of the Earth system. Okay. How are you doing with the remote following? Are you hearing me okay with the mic? Just nod if it's all okay. Everything okay? Amelia? I think so, yeah. Everything's okay on Zoom? Yes? Okay, good, I think. Okay, I see a nod. Okay, we won't be going into too much detail about the hydrological cycle. As I said, the clouds play a role in this hydrological cycle, mainly because it was at one point covered in a second term course by Erica, which won't be taking place this year. So I'll be talking a little bit about this here, but I'll try and put some more information on the hydrological cycle of the actual water itself, the runoff and the flow, in the modelling part of the course. So this will mostly be in a course that takes place essentially after Christmas, when you're back with me again. Okay. And so, as I said in the radiation part of the course, we'll be talking about the effects of clouds, and we'll also be talking about energy balance models. So that comes after the dry thermodynamics. So we'll be talking about, for example, the greenhouse effects, as I said, the way the different gases interact with the, should we say, the radiation transfer. And the aim of that part of the course will be to derive, one of the things we'll be doing together, will be to derive a slab model of the greenhouse effect. So what we'll do is we'll do an energy balance model that says, what would the surface temperature be if we just simply had a ball of rock? And then we can add an atmosphere over that. Okay, where we actually then calculate analytically what we expect the surface temperature to be in the presence of an atmosphere which allows the solar radiation to pass through unimpeded but is actually absorbing a proportion of the radiation that goes back to space, a great body. And then we'll make that a little bit more complicated, we'll go to a two-layer system, and then we'll talk about the reasons why if we go to a multiple-layer system that model actually breaks down. Okay, which we're then trying to improve that model in the convection part of this course. Okay. Last year it didn't go very well, but I tried to do a hands-on module. I'm going to try and improve it this time. So we actually maybe try and... I forgot to turn my phone off. Sorry. Let me just turn the sound off. This is always embarrassing when I forget to do that. In the convection part of the course, we're trying to do a Python notebook where we actually do a calculation of a multi-layer model, okay, interactively, which is kind of a fun thing to do, and we can see why the radiation model then actually breaks down. Okay. So anyway, does anybody know, by the way, what that value roughly is? So if we take away the atmosphere and we just calculate the surface temperature, assuming that the reflectivity of the Earth is still the same, even though we don't have an atmosphere, so we just pretend that we paint the clouds onto the surface with a shiny brush, so to speak. So we assume that the albedo, the reflectivity, is the same. Does anybody know what the mean temperature would be?
I don't understand your question.
So if we take away the atmosphere, how much colder would we actually be at a mean temperature? So what is the mean temperature roughly today?
20 degrees?
Yeah, a little bit less, but we're getting up there. So on the order of, say, 18 or so. Global mean, okay.
It should be hotter than...
So without the atmosphere, no,
yeah,
it would be much cooler. Because of the greenhouse effect. So the mean temperature we're going to work out will actually be around 255 Kelvin, okay, so that's minus 18, compared to a mean temperature now, I say 18, it's actually around 16. So plus 16, it would be around minus 18, okay. So that's the difference the atmosphere makes, okay, it'll be a lot colder, okay. Whereas, if we were just to simply have the atmosphere but take away the clouds, the net impact of the clouds is actually a small cooling impact. So we'd actually be warmer still without the clouds by a good 10 to 15 degrees, depending on how you make the calculations, but around 30 degrees. So clouds have a net cooling impact, okay, and the atmosphere has a net warming impact due to the greenhouse effect. So we'll be talking about that in the radiation part of the course, where we make a simple model to try and show that. Okay. One other thing, just to say, even though clouds cool the atmosphere today, it doesn't mean that they offset global warming, because it's a sign of the change that's important. So in a future atmosphere, if the clouds get less, they cool today. In the future, if there are less clouds, they will cool less, and that acts to amplify global warming. Okay. On the other hand, in the future, if the cloud cover actually increases, they could actually act to cool the atmosphere even more, and that would offset global warming. That would be a negative feedback. Okay. So one of the things we'll see in the second terms course, those of you that continue with the climate, we'll be looking at the fact that clouds, in fact, are one of the most uncertain parts of climate modelling. Okay. Okay. So, again, this is another picture of, should we say, cloud systems, but in this one I've tried to highlight some of the cloud systems that we will find around. So, again, it's a composite snapshot, okay, and we can see this actually is not shown very well on this projector. On these areas here, I've actually put an arrow here because we've got grey low cloud. These are kind of stratocumulus areas. Okay, we'll see why these occur. Then this here is actually, the equator is about here. I haven't put lat and long on this, I'm afraid. I've just taken the picture as a photo. I should actually try and put some lat long. But the equator is here, so just north of the equator, these speckly white is basically the tops of thunderstorms, okay, which are reaching right up towards the tropopause, just below the tropopause. Okay. So these speckles are smaller systems, these larger blobs would be perhaps multiple thunderstorms that are contributing to a larger cloud shield. Okay. And here we have some very large convective clusters in the tropics, okay, leading to very large convection, should we say, coverages, okay. And here we have some frontal systems, okay, and then which you can see at the higher latitudes. So if you actually get at any time you want a break from study and actually, should we say, following my course or anybody else's course for that matter, one of the things that's quite fun to do is perhaps have a look in data and get lost in data. So before I actually start all the thermodynamics, I just wanted to show you super quickly, if you saw my website here, this was the diploma page. I've actually got another page here called Current Weather,
And if you click on that, you'll find that there's a lot of weather links, some of which are for Trieste. If you remember, I sent around a message on Slack that at 2:30 on Fridays, we have a little weather discussion in our group. Okay. And some of the things are quite nice. One of them, for example, is zoom.earth. So if you look under the satellite data, I don't know if any of you have seen this. Have you seen, this is Zoom Earth? Okay. And so it's got a picture, basically, which is put together with composites. It's showing the, should we say, the locations here of basically tropical cyclones or hurricanes, depending which basin you're in. Okay. And then you can zoom through, should we say, different times. Go back a day like this. Let's take a day when we are. And then you can basically zoom down and down and down, and it's really pretty amazing, these structures. Remember what I said about the percentage of cloud cover? You can see straight away, if you look at this, how your assessment of your cloud cover is going to depend on your satellite resolution. Okay? Because you can imagine that a very coarse scale satellite we had in the past, if you had a pixel like this, if only a small amount is cloudy, you'll probably miss it and think that that grid box is clear. Okay. Or vice versa. No, if you look at an area like this and you take a large pixel, then it's mostly cloudy and the coarse scale satellite would say it's cloudy, but it would be missing the clear locations. Okay. So if you look through this, you'll see some amazing, this is a visible imagery, so you can see linear organization of shallow convection. If you zoom out, you see all these amazing spatial scales. So we see basically, you can see it looks like pool shapes where you have clouds on a boundary around a pool of descending air. So you get these basically, or you get these blobs of clouds which are surrounded by large areas of basic clear sky. So you get these open and closed cells patterns. You can see some amazing structures here where you see changes in the scale of the organization of these shallow clouds. So you can see the size of these units is decreasing as we move from west towards east here. Okay. So when we get to the part of the course we talk about convection, we'll see that this is basically, if you imagine it, the surface, it's the size of the eddies. Okay. So as we move and we get larger cells spatially, it's because the boundary layer of the eddies mixing that's creating these clouds is getting deeper and deeper. So the size of the dominant circulation scale as the layer of the mixing gets deeper is also getting wider. So you get a wider scale until it breaks up into this different format where you have the clouds going up in the middle and then descending areas. So this is where these are probably raining, like producing small amounts of rain, whereas this is non-precipitating cloud. Okay. So it's super exciting, and we're only, you know, really starting to get to the bottom of what causes the kind of dynamics with wind shear and so that causes all these different structural, should we say, things. You can spend hours and hours and hours just floating around the Earth looking at these images. Okay. So I've got quite a few links on this website here, and during the course of the course I might pick out one or two as we go along, things like the tephigrams and so on, and show you these from time to time. So if you find interesting, I mean, you just zoom down, you can see these open structures and then these lines on the edges here. It's incredible. But you can see what I mean about clouds being ubiquitous. When you start to look at this image here, you really see where it's very difficult to navigate around and actually find an area of the globe which is not actually pretty much dominated by clouds, only here, maybe over the Sahara. And even there, we've got this system here, look, on this particular day. Okay. So, let's go back to the lectures. So I'm just finishing off here with a chart of cloud types. So some of these we'll be talking about in the convection, should we say, part of this course. So we can see clouds are kind of
divided up in terms of where they occur in the troposphere, so roughly low, medium, and high, okay? So low, you can see roughly here, it really depends on each person as their definition what they consider low clouds, but generally we say in the lowest couple of kilometers. So we'll see that there's a layer where the air is very effectively mixed, which is normally on the order of 500 to 1,000 meters in depth, okay? But it can be much deeper, that lowest layer. Over the Sahara Desert, we can see it gets up to 4 or 5 kilometers, okay? And then we have middle clouds, and then high clouds are basically the layer that's below the, should we say, the tropopause. So this upper boundary really depends on where you are. In the tropics, this upper boundary would be 15 kilometers, in mid-latitudes, 10 kilometers. And the cloud types are classified really about their vertical extent, whether or not they're just flat and layered, or whether they actually have vertical motion. Okay. So things such as like cumulus is basically from a Latin expression that means kind of vertical piling. So clouds that have vertical motion. So these are clouds that are normally associated with vertical instability. Okay. So we're going to be talking about that in the convection part of the course, where, you know, often the atmosphere is close to being unstable. It's like a pencil balanced on its end, you know, just needs a small perturbation and the pencil will fall over. And so we'll find that when that happens, we can get vertical motions, which may be restricted for a few kilometers, such as fair weather cumulus, or they might get all the way through the whole troposphere and actually cause intense rainfall, okay, such as cumulonimbus. So the nimbus here means basically it's raining, it's producing precipitation. Okay. Whereas stratus tends to be layered clouds, and so most stratiform kind clouds are usually in situations where we have quite strong stability, and it stops vertical motion of the particles. So we'll be going through all of these kind of concepts of these different kinds of, shall we say, clouds, and that we get, for example, layered clouds in terms of, should we say, cirrus, that's actually produced by convection. Okay. And here's some, should we say, some other examples of, should we say, deep cumulonimbus clouds, more shallow cumulus clouds. So when we looked at that satellite picture and we looked at those structures and we saw the layer getting deeper and moving towards those kind of, should we say, open cells, we were looking at this kind of cloud here. In the deep tropics, where we saw those big mesoscale systems, it was essentially cumulonimbus. Okay. So that's what we're going to be covering in the cloud part of the course. Right. So today, because it's an introductory lecture, I'm actually a little bit ahead of time, 10 minutes ahead, but I'm actually going to give you these extra 10 minutes today. We're going to finish early because tomorrow I'm going to start with the dry thermodynamics. Okay, at the board. So we changed gear a little bit. Today was really just a kind of a show and tell to talk about some of the concepts we're going to cover in this course. Okay. Do any of you have any questions? I said about the handout. As I mentioned in the Slack, normally what happens is once I start, I remember all the things I meant to change at the end of the course the last year, and I start hacking and adding things. I've already changed the thermodynamics quite a lot over the weekend and last weekend and so on. So if you don't mind, don't print out the whole 170 pages, because especially there are some changes I wanted to make to the radiation part of the course, and also a little bit in the cumulus part of the course. And so it would change. You know, you can obviously, you know, download the whole thing, you put it on the computer, but it's probably, you know, at the moment just to print out the chapters that we're actually covering, because it will evolve as it goes along. You'll see the version number on the front, okay? So just the dry and the moist thermodynamics. There are some exercises at the back. As I said, Giovanni this year is actually working to add some new exercises. If you want to try some extra problems as well, there are a few exam sheets online, and I'll be updating those as well. Those don't actually, I don't have the answers uploaded, whereas the exercises do, so I'm slowly in the process of moving some of the exam questions into the exercises. And Giovanni, from week 3, will start to have these sessions where you can go through some of those exercises with him once a week if you want to, okay? Do any of you have any other questions? wanted. So, Amelia, you're watching on the Zoom. Was that okay? Could you understand and hear okay?
Thank you.
Okay. If you have any problems, just contact me, you know, send me an email or... when Giovanni runs the classes, he'll be running them as well with Zoom switched on, so you can sign in for those as well, okay?
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
No problem. Good. Okay, well, if nobody has any questions, I shall stick my mask on and I will see you tomorrow at the same time, 4 o'clock, no? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.